I've been with Calgary Bible Training Center, I think, from the very beginning, even when the project was in the womb, because I met Adalbert and Sally in a home group, and I caught their vision and passion, and because we work as full-time missionaries now in Romania, which is in Eastern Europe, we created the same thing over there. So that passion is kind of contagious, and I bless you with the same kind of passion. So to multiply everything that's going on in the school. The blood covenant, it's very dear to my heart because I have received it through revelation. And my prayer for you is that you are gonna catch it as a revelation, not as simple information, because it changes everything. You know, questions like, why was Eve cut from Adam's body? Why wasn't she created the same way Adam was created? Why did God want to kill Moses' sons in the wilderness? Why did he keep the sun a day and a half and a night, you know, so Joshua can win a battle against some people who actually tricked him? Why would God do that? How was it possible for Abraham to bring his son as a sacrifice? What was going through his mind, through his heart, that he was capable to do that? What's up with the circumcision? Why are the Jewish people circumcised? Why is the genealogy of Jesus the way it is, and why did he have to come at a certain point in history, and what happened at the cross, and where do we stand regarding that? So these are all questions that sometimes we go through the Bible and we might not have answers. So I hope that you'll find your answer through the Blood Covenant teaching. Now, we live in a world of contracts, right? We are so used to contracts. I used to be a human resources manager and I drafted many contracts. And you've also heard about premarital contracts and other sorts of contracts, right? But they are as good as the parties involved are. Those contracts, actually, when I worked as a human resources manager, the largest amount of time was spent on the termination clause. That's where we paid the most attention. What's gonna happen when the contract is gonna be broken? So the contract was meant to be broken, and we were trying to protect the company in that breaking of the contract. The same with the marriage contracts, right? So what's the point of the contract? The contract assumes that the marriage will be broken, and that's what's gonna happen in that context of the separation, right? So the contract is meant to limit responsibilities and protect rights. Like in an employment contract, I'm coming on a job description and I say, these are my responsibilities, and in replacement for that, I get paid that much. If you add more responsibilities, you'll have to pay me more, right? So a contract, it's meant to limit your responsibilities and to protect your rights. But what a covenant? What is a covenant? Because when we grasp the understanding of covenant, we will grasp something special in the Bible, because the Bible is written in covenant language. It's not written in contract language. But because we are so indoctrinated in this culture with contracts, we do not grasp some depth of the Bible because of that. So what's a covenant? What is a covenant? Certain parts of the world, even Africa, Eastern Asia, they still practice covenant. But what is it? So I'm going to give you the definition. I'm okay if you can, at any time, you can step in and say something or ask questions, please feel free. Let's figure it out together. The blood covenant, it's known as the oldest and most enduring and solemn contract known to man. We call it contract because we do not have any other word. But the thing is, it's an unbreakable contract. It's something that cannot be broken, believe it or not. And historians who have studied covenants, they followed over 8 generations and they realized that the covenant hasn't been broken. That's how powerful it is. It involves the giving of one's life, person, resources to the the covenant partner. Okay? Assets, liabilities, everything that I am, it's being given to the covenant partner. It absolutely cannot be broken. And I want to remember that about the covenant. If that's all you remember from tonight's teaching, remember that the covenant cannot be broken. Because if someone breaks a covenant, they are supposed to die. They will be killed. That's how serious they are. It is sealed by blood. That's why it's called a blood covenant. And such covenant is cut. So a blood covenant is not made, it's cut. Let's cut a covenant. Okay? There are three important aspects of covenants. First of all, the blood. You have to see it in the Bible. The blood is sacred. And life is in the blood. If you look in Leviticus, we see that life is in the blood. So whenever there is a blood exchange, it involves the life of the person who gives the blood. That's why God was advising the Jewish people, or he was forbidden them to eat the blood or to drink the blood of an animal. Because life is in the blood. It's a sacred thing. A blood covenant is the highest form of relationship and it supersedes the natural one. So once I'm in covenant with someone, we become covenant brothers, that relationship is stronger than the natural relationship, like my brothers or sisters. So my covenant partner is closer to me than my own brothers are. That's how important covenant is. The blood covenant is a pledge of life and resources on the part of the covenant partners. Failure to live up to the covenant leads to death. And we'll explain more. Those are just a few definitions and some important aspects of the covenant, just for you to understand. Now, covenants were very well known from the very beginning of history. So if we go even from the Garden of Eden, because that's where it all started, with the blood sacrifice of the animals and then covering up Adam and Eve. But from that moment on, in every nation in the ancient times, covenants were common practice. What was the purpose of a blood covenant? So a blood covenant involves two people coming together, cutting a covenant for a purpose. They want to obtain something. It's always a relationship. So two people come in a covenant for that particular relationship that's obtained at the end. Like think of marriage. Why do two people get married? Because of the relationship, not because of the wedding, not because of the ceremony, not because of the dress. Those are part of the ceremony. But they want to get that relationship, being together, loving each other, giving themselves one to another. So the point of a covenant is to obtain a relationship, a love relationship that the Bible calls it hesed. You'll find that word in the Bible, hesed, which is a mutual responsibility and right of the people in covenant. So that's the reason people cut a blood covenant, to get into that special relationship, to be joined together. They will do it for love. If you look back in history, we see people cutting covenants for love. Because they love, and if you look in the Bible, Jonathan and David, they love themselves so much that they cut a love covenant. But we don't get in the Bible yet. We just talk about the covenant from a worldly perspective in an ancient time. For protection. When two people are in covenant, and we cut the covenant because I want you to protect me and I'm here to protect you, whenever a tribe or an army would attack one member of the covenant, the other one would jump with all the resources protect the covenant partner. And it was for business. So when two business partners get into a covenant, they don't take advantage of each other. So it's going to be a safe relationship. They are not going to cheat. They are going to support each other. So those were the main reasons that people would cut blood covenants from the old times. Even, I told you, in some cultures today, in Africa and Asia, covenants are still common practice. Now, it's called a blood covenant because it's sealed by blood. So blood is always involved. Now, my knowledge of covenants when I was younger, I think it was just limited to the three musketeers. I'm sure you all know the book. And you know the three musketeers became brothers by covenant. They cut themselves and they would carry that sign. And people knew that they were in covenant. But pretty much, that's what a covenant is. People come together, they mingle their blood, and from they have an oath, and we'll see all the steps of a covenant, and from then on, they live for each other. So, how was the blood mingled? They had different methods. One was the cutting of the palm and then shaking hands, and that's the origin of handshake. You know, maybe you are wondering, why do we shake hands? Because in the past, they would cut the palm of their hand, they would shake hands in order to mingle the blood. And that's how the blood was just transferred from one partner to the other. Cutting the wrist and mingling the blood was another practice to draw blood. And another one was to cut the wrist and to let the blood flow into a wine, into a cup filled with wine, and then the blood would get mingled and the partners would drink it. Or, as we see it in the Old Testament in the Bible, the practice was to replace the human blood with the blood of an animal. That's why you have so much blood in the Bible and so much sprinkling with blood. It is the symbol of a blood covenant, and we'll see which one. So what were the steps? So let's see the ceremony now, the whole process of cutting the covenant. It's really important to understand that because you'll see it in the covenant that Jesus cut with the Father later on. But let's look at the, like, again, think of a wedding. The whole ceremony has some particular steps and everybody wants to follow those. It's the same with the covenant. So first of all, the two parties will get together, let's say two people want to cut a covenant for whatever reason, protection, love. So they get together and they discuss the terms of the covenant. What do we want to get out of this covenant? What are we going to give? What am I going to get? How are we going to work it out? So they sit down and discuss. And when they agree on the terms of the covenant, they come face to face and the ceremony starts. And there is always a priest that witnesses the ceremony. Same as a wedding, once again. So the wedding is pretty much a form of a blood covenant that has roots in that practice in the past. So the two people would come together and first they would have an exchange of coats. So I have a priest and I have my covenant partner. The priest is witnessing everything, and maybe we have other witnesses, family members and friends watching us. But between the two of us, first we exchange our coats. And what's the coat? What does the coat symbolize? Like guys who've been in the army, they know that the coat is it's a sign of authority. You know, you look at the symbols on the coat and you know the rank of the person based on that coat. So when I exchange coats, the message is my authority is now being transferred to you. So everything that I am, what I stand for, is going to be transferred to you. So that was the authority of the person that was passed to the covenant partner. And then it was an exchange of weapons. In the past they had simple weapons, but usually they had a belt with the smaller weapons, with the knives and later on guns, and they would exchange that belt as a sign of strength. From now on, my strength is going to be made available to you. Whenever you claim it, whenever you need it, I'm going to come and fight for you. Exchange of names. So in that covenant ceremony, the second name of each person would be transferred to the covenant partner. So that's how we have the marriage exchange of names, because marriage is a covenant, but it started with that practice. So what's the name of a person? What's in the name? It's the identity of the person, right? Because each of you go by a name, and because of that name, we know who you are. It represents. So when I pass it on to my covenant partner, all I'm saying is that from now on, I'm one with you. My identity moves to you. We become one. It's no longer me and you. We have a common name. We become one. And then it was an exchange of vows. So what would they do? They would take animals, big or small, and they would cut them lengthwise. And they would split them aside, and there's going to be a pool of blood in the middle. And they would just walk. They would have a number 8, a sign of infinity. You know, they would walk in that blood. They would complete that walk, and in that walk of blood, as we call it, then they would declare their vows. So they would speak out some vows, and the priest would witness those vows. So the vows consisted in what kind of resources I'm making available, how am I going to make them available, how I'm giving myself to you. All those things were spoken in the walk of blood. Another, the following step, it was a pronouncement of blessings and curses. While they were still in the blood, they would speak out the blessings of the covenant. This is what's going to come out of this covenant, and that's how we are going to bless each other. But they will also speak curses. And those curses were very powerful, and because of those curses, nobody would break a covenant. And a mild one would be that the same way that that this animal has been split in half and spilled its blood, that's what's going to happen to the one who breaks the covenant. But this is just a milder curse. But they had more severe curses. And later on in history, in all those groups that we know them, like Freemasons or other groups, there are curses spoken generationally. And those curses have power. That's why people, it's very hard to come out from those groups because of the curses that were spoken. And even when they come out, if those curses are not broken, they continue on the generational line. So those curses spoken in the context of a covenant, the blood covenant, they have power. So they pronounced the blessings and curses while they were still in the blood. And then they would shed their own blood by cutting. So as I told you before, they could cut their palm, they could cut their wrist, and as they do this blood exchange, they have a solemn oath when they declare faithfulness to each other. And that again was witnessed by the priest who was there in the ceremony. Now, following the cut, they would want to get a permanent seal, so people would be able to see that they are in a covenant. So they would take a dark substance, would be ashes, would be dust, and later on it was gunpowder, and they would sprinkle that on the cut. So the seal would become visible. So it's going to be a scar that's going to be noticeable by other people. So by seeing the scar, we know that they are in covenant. One of the methods of cutting themselves was to cut their index finger and let the blood flow in a cup of wine. And from there, we have the index finger, or the index finger where they wear the wedding band, right? Many things are linked to the covenant practice. Okay, and then it was the setting up of a memorial. So at the end of the ceremony, they would do something to remind even the next generation about this particular covenant. They would either dig a well, or they would plant a tree, or they would pile some stones. And as you read the Bible, you will see that being done many times, because there are many covenants in the Bible. And then eating of the covenant meal. So at the end of the ceremony, they would have a covenant meal, but before the big feast, they would have bread and wine. And they would break the bread and put it in each other's mouth and say, "This is my body that's broken from you. As we eat from this bread, we become one. And this is my blood," they would say, "for the wine that's being spilled for you. As we drink from this wine, we become one." So that was the covenant language and the covenant practice. What was the final outcome? So the two partners, they were going through the whole deal, you know, the whole ceremony, the blessings, the curses, the declarations, the exchanges. But what was happening at the end, or what was the point, as we discussed before, of the covenant? At the end, the two covenant partners, they were called friends. That was a very precious word. We lost the meaning of that word. Now everybody is friend with everybody, with the salesperson, with the driver, cab taxi driver, with the neighbor, we are friends. But in the past, that word was very precious. And Jesus comes later on and he says, "I'm calling you my friends." So it has power, but only understood in the context of a blood covenant. So that was the relationship, and it was a relationship governed by love, by mutual respect, by giving each other to the covenant partner. So, the covenant is not the point. The point of the covenant is the ongoing relationship that's obtained at the end of the covenant. It's a relationship, as I told you before, called Hesed, which is mercy, love, protection, combined with commitment to keep every word of the covenant. So the two of them were going to that ritual because they wanted to obtain that solid relationship, that love relationship, that Hesed relationship. So that was the final outcome of a covenant. Now, when the covenants were cut between larger groups or families, or tribes or villages, they would select one representative. So they wouldn't cut the covenant with all the people in the group. They would select one representative, and one of each tribe would come face to face, would go through the ritual. They had to be part of that particular tribe or family to understand their needs. They would be the guarantor of the covenant. In case the covenant is broken, the person who cut the covenant on behalf of everybody else would be killed, so on and so forth. So that was an important role. So they would choose their representative wisely, to be someone who's capable to enforce the covenant, who's understanding the needs of the family they are cutting the covenant on behalf of, and the entire process. So that was the representative. It's one who stands in the place of another and is authorized to act or speak on behalf of the rest of the group. And everybody else is known to be in him. And I want you to become familiar with the language, because as you read the Bible, you start seeing these things. Okay? We are in him. We are in Christ. We are hidden with Christ in God. You will see the covenant language more and more. So, I am in my representative. If I am behind him, if I'm part of the family, then I am in him. So, as I told you, he must know the needs and desires of those in his group. He has to be of the same blood as the family of who he's representing. He is known as the guarantor of the covenant, because he is the one responsible to keep the covenant. It is his responsibility to ensure that all the promises and terms of the covenant are kept. He also acts as the substitute for the entire group and pays the penalties on behalf of the group. If there is any debt involved or anything else, he would be responsible. Okay. I want to just bring you closer to our time, and I don't know if you are familiar with Livingstone and Stanley and how Africa was open to the gospel, but here is like Livingstone. He was a British researcher and believer, and he was going into the jungle of the Amazon to investigate who's living there, who's living there and what's going on and how he can take the gospel, and he has disappeared. So Britain lost connection with him. And here it's an American general, Stanley, who's willing to go and find Livingstone in the jungle. So Stanley starts this journey into the jungle to find Livingstone, and he has a local guide that's just opening the way for him and his party. I'm sorry, I don't have a printout of that, but so it's going to be very hard for you to read, but I'm going to read it for you, and next time I'm going to give you the printout. Because this is interesting. This happens in 1869, which is much closer to our time. This is not in the ancient world. It's closer to our days, yet it reflects the practice of the blood covenant so well. So it says, in 1869, the New York Herald newspaper sent their overseas news correspondent, Henry Stanley, to find the Scottish missionary and explorer Dr. David Livingstone. Dr. Livingstone has disappeared for 6 years, and Stanley was sent to prove he was not dead. In 1871, Stanley found Livingstone. You'll even find a documentary on YouTube about that kind of journey. During his expedition, Stanley came in contact with a powerful African tribe, but he was in no condition to fight them. When his interpreter suggested he make a covenant with the tribal chieftain, Stanley did so, which requires first days of negotiations with the chief. After the terms of the covenant were reached, an exchange of gifts ensued. The chief wanted Stanley's gold and nothing less in exchange for his 7-foot spear. Stanley reluctantly yielded, but felt he got the lesser end of the deal. The gold had provided Stanley's much-needed meal for his health, so what good would be a spear to him? Or a spear, sorry. More than he realized. Next, the tribal priest brought forth a cup of wine. The old chief selected one of his sons, a prince, and required Stanley to select an Englishman. Both became substitutes for the covenant makers and representatives of the two parties. The priest made an incision in each man's wrist and let their blood drip into the wine. The cup was stirred and they each drank from the mixed blood and wine. Then the priest pronounced terrible curses over Then Stanley's interpreter pronounced curses over the chieftain, his family, and tribe. Curses that would come upon anyone who broke the covenant. Finally, the two men rubbed their cutlass together along with gunpowder to mingle their blood and become blood brothers. The gunpowder remained as a visible mark of their covenant. This act not only bound Stanley and the chieftain together, it included the tribal warriors with the company of Englishmen. The blood brotherhood became permanent and the tree was planted as a memorial of the covenant. After the covenant ceremony, the chieftain declared to his people, "Come, buy and sell with Stanley, for he is our blood brother." From then on, Stanley and his men no longer guarded their possessions. Nothing was touched. To steal from Stanley and his men was to break the covenant and steal from the chieftain himself, an act which brought the penalty of death. Everywhere Stanley went in Africa, the spear proved to be more powerful than the goat. The copper wood spear carried the old chieftain's authority, and everybody bowed to him and submitted to him. But blood covenant was so sacred it was never broken by anyone. Neither Stanley or Livingstone ever witnessed anyone breaking it. No one could remain alive in Africa who broke a covenant. The curses would overtake them, carried out by the people bound to the covenant. Covenants were so revered that children to the third and fourth generations would keep it. Henry Stanley, on his explorations to Africa, cut covenant 50 times with various chieftains. Anytime he would come across an unfriendly tribe, he would just hold up the right arm with those 50 scars, and any would-be attacker would take off running in the other direction. So this is an article in the New York Herald. You can find it online. I can print it out and give it to you next time. But that pretty much describes the practice and the benefits of a blood covenant. So once they cut the covenant, no tribe dared to touch Stanley and his party because it would be to attack the other tribe who was the most feared in the entire jungle. And through those covenants, Livingstone and Stanley have opened Africa to the gospel. They were able to bring the gospel because of the protection that those covenants brought to them. So I would like you to keep that in mind as we will move into the Bible and try to understand why we have a covenant God. Why God is speaking in covenant language. Because we have to read the Bible is split between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. We call it Testament, but the actual word is covenant. So it's about an Old Covenant, and that's referring to the covenant that Moses did with God, and the New Covenant in Jesus Christ. So unless we understand the covenant language and the covenant implications, it's hard to grasp what God was trying to say to us. The message of the covenant is, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will always be there for you, to protect you, to love you, to nourish you. So that's the message of a covenant. And when we speak about Bible covenants, they all have a positive message. Covenants can be conditional or unconditional. We can have conditions, the two parties can speak conditions, or it can be a fully unconditional covenant. I'm going to do that to you no matter what. Marriage is supposed to be an unconditional covenant. I'm giving myself fully to my partner. And that's how God sees it. And we will see how God perceives covenants. Because we have a covenant God. And before God even created us, he had a blood covenant in mind. Why? Because the Bible says that the Lamb was sacrificed before the foundation of the world. So the blood for the covenant was prepared by God before the foundation of the world. Because he is a covenant God. He cannot love us. He cannot express his love outside covenant. Because we would understand his love in the context of that covenant. So God created Adam for a covenant relationship. And if we look in Hosea, God says that Adam has broken the covenant. The first covenant between God and Adam and Eve didn't have blood because other than, keep in mind, Eve was cut from Adam. So Eve was brought into covenant with Adam from the very beginning. Their marriage was a covenant marriage. That's why she had to be cut, and that's why blood had to for that covenant. But between God and Adam, it wasn't a blood covenant in the beginning. And it was a covenant based on God gives some instructions, and out of love, Adam would obey. And in Hosea, it says that Adam broke the covenant. So God told him, listen, I've created everything for you. I want you to be the ruler over everything. If you look in Genesis 1:26, man was created to rule. That's why we are trying to get on the moon and to gain political power, because we've been created to rule in a good godly context. Okay? So God gave him everything except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That was something that God said, I'm going to leave it there because I want the free choice and the free obedience. Yet, I'm telling you, don't touch it. Because if you do, our connection, our covenant is going to be broken. God created us to be with one partner only. And that's for you to go and check Malachi 2:14. That's the heart of God for marriage. One partner who treats the other partner rightfully. Covenants in the biblical times spoke volumes to the nations around Israel. They were very familiar with covenants, and we'll move into the Joshua story and we'll see what happened there. Because covenant was commonly practiced, and if you go and read Jeremiah 34 from verse 12 and up, and I would like you to read it, you'll see how common the covenant practice was. And we spoke about the fact that the covenant in the blood of the Lamb was also in God's heart from the beginning, actually before creation. And you have that in Revelation 13:8. So, God takes covenant serious. And now we are in that story with Joshua. And you find that story in Joshua 9, verses 3 to 6, and then 19 and 20. If you have your Bibles, we can read those verses. But I'll tell you the story briefly. So Joshua was mandated by God to move into the Canaan and conquer all those territories and all those nations. So of course the fame of Joshua is moving fast ahead of him. And here are some people further in the Canaan, the inhabitants of Gibeonites. And they've heard about what Joshua is doing and how he's wiping the other nations. So the Bible says that they worked craftily and they tricked Joshua into cutting a covenant. So these people are coming, and I encourage you to go and read the story, read the entire story. But they pretend that they come from far, far away. So Joshua was mandated to conquer and to take Canaan for Israel. So he was supposed to wipe out every nation and to enter into Canaan and become, that's the land that God has promised Abraham, and now Joshua was supposed to move into that land. So the Gibeonites pretended that they come from far, far away, not from Canaan, but from far, far away. Their clothes were old and ripped, they had moldy bread in their bags, their sandals were broken. Like, the impression was that they came from far, far away. So they presented themselves to Joshua and they said, well, we are not from these people here in Canaan, because they knew Joshua has a mandate to wipe them out. We are coming from far away and we want to cut a covenant with you, because when we move into Canaan, we will be your neighbors, so we want to protect each other. So Joshua, he was familiar with the covenant practice, he cut the covenant with the Gibeonites. But as he moved into the territory of Canaan, guess what? He's met the Gibeonites, and he realized that he's been tricked. So here is the assembly of the elders in Israel discussing, what are we going to do? And God said, no, you cannot break the covenant, even though you were tricked into cutting that covenant. Because that's the heart of God when it's coming to covenants. That's why he takes every covenant seriously, and we should be the same. Because it's never his heart to break a covenant, not even when it was done under a false pretense. So they became, the Gibeonites, they became kind of slaves for Israel, so they were tending to them, they were helping them. But when the Gibeonites were attacked later on, they ran to Joshua and they said, now protect us because our territory is being attacked and we have a covenant and you are supposed to protect us. And Joshua had to fight for them and protect them. And that's when one of the greatest miracles in the Bible took place, when God kept the sun on the sky for a day and a night for Joshua to win victory against the attackers of the Gibeonites. So just think about it. God would have said, wow, they are liars, they are cheaters, they were supposed to be destroyed anyway, they are on your territory, kick them out. But he didn't say that. And we have to understand the heart of God, because many times we take things lightly. And again, I relate it to marriage because that's what's very familiar to us. But many times we take the marriage covenant lightly when the heart of God is the one that's reflected there in the Bible. Another story, I said I'm not going to tell you stories, but I also wanted to read it. It's in 1 Samuel 18, and you have verses 1-4, and then 20-42, and then it continues in 2 Samuel 9-7. And that's an example of how the covenant is honored over generations. So what happened, if you are familiar, it was David and Jonathan. Saul was king before David, and Saul became more fearful of men than he was of God, and he cared more about men's opinion about God's opinion, right? We recognize that, many of us. And God was, his heart was set to replace Saul, and he's grooming David, he's preparing David. Saul had a son, his name is Jonathan. And David and Jonathan became very good friends. And the Bible said that they loved each other, that even their souls were intertwined. And they cut a love covenant, and in that covenant, they promised to look after each other and over their the next generation, over their children. So the covenant was to protect each other, but to protect the generations coming after them. And Saul and Jonathan were caught in a battle. They both died. And here is David approaching the throne. But in that process, in the battle where Saul and Jonathan were killed, Jonathan had a son, and his name was Mephibosheth. And the nurse, like the nanny who took care of Mephibosheth, when she learned the news about his father and grandfather being killed, she scooped him and ran to protect him, but she dropped him in the process. She was very young, maybe around 4 or 5 years old, so he broke a leg and he became lame. He couldn't walk properly after that. So Mephibosheth, which is Jonathan's son, so he was the grandson of the king, he's now living somewhere in exile. And think about it, in exile he made his friends, he made his home, that's everything that he knew because he was there for many, many years. But when David becomes king, someone reminds him of that covenant. And David is really touched by that, and he's asking, like, is there anybody from Jonathan's line that's still alive? And he's told that Mephibosheth is still alive. So he calls for Mephibosheth, he brings him to the palace, and he gives him the highest honor because David was in covenant with Mephibosheth's father, so that honor was passed on to the next generation. So David honored that covenant that he cut with Jonathan. And we have a covenant God. Another example of covenant that you might, and this is an example of the representative. I think you are familiar with David and Goliath. That's a story that everybody knows, you know, but what's behind that story? So here are the two armies, the Israelites and the Philistines. And the Philistines were well equipped. They were the first one to master the metal technique, and they were creating armors and weapons, so they were very well equipped. Their number was greater, and they had the giants. So we know, the Bible history tells us that it was a period of time when we had giants living on earth. So some of them were in the Philistines' army. One of them was Goliath. So you have this strong army, and then you have the Israelites, and they were led by Saul at the time. And they are on two hills, and there is a valley between them. But what were they thinking? Rather than fighting each other, how about we select a representative? And whoever wins, everybody who's in that representative is going to win, and everybody who loses is going to be defeated. So instead of fighting, they selected a representative. And the Philistines selected Goliath, and the Israelites couldn't find anybody because Goliath was just walking down that field, and he was just yelling and shouting, and he was impressive, and he was big, and he was well equipped, and everybody was afraid to fight with him. Like, David was young at the time, but he had experiences with God down the road in his life. So he was actually supposed to bring food to his brothers who were in the army, and to bring a report back to the father and tell the father what's going on. So how are the brothers? And so he gets there and he sees the Israelites, you know, so trembling and fearful, and he says, "I want to go and face Goliath." And everybody like looking at him like, "No way." But because it was nobody else brave enough to fight Goliath, David was presented to Saul, and Saul gave him his approval. Saul also gave him his armor, but that was so heavy on David, he couldn't handle it, so he said no. So he went in the sling, and he picked a few stones from the valley, and that's how he went to fight Goliath. And we all know the outcome of that battle. We know how Goliath was defeated. But what's really interesting is that it shows you the power of an agreement, which it was a covenant between the two parties. They selected a representative, they had a deal. So Goliath was defeated, but think of the Philistines' army. It was still strong, powerful, well-equipped, higher in number. They could have easily attacked the Israelites and win. But because of that agreement they had, because of that covenant, they ran away, and the Israelites followed them and killed many of them, so it was a bloody battle. But not because the Philistines were not capable. They were defeated because of the covenant, the agreement that was made between the two armies, between David and Goliath as representatives. That's how powerful a covenant is. So we have a covenant God. God comes into a covenant with us, not because he needs to have a covenant, but that's the way he shows us how much he loves us and how serious he is. So the original language of the first people was the covenant language. So God had to prove his love for them through covenants. So in order to see his heart, in order to see his loving kindness, in order to see that his love and mercy, he's willing to come and cut covenant with men. And God's covenant love is greater than the covenant. And the ultimate promise of all those covenants that God cut in the past was the sending of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, we needed a representative. As a human race, we needed a representative to cut a covenant with God in our behalf. That's why God couldn't have saved us from heaven. Many people say, why was it required for Jesus to come on earth? Why did he have to come in a human shape? Why couldn't God solve this problem, you know, from heaven? That's why. Because we needed a representative to be part of our family, to be like us, to understand us, to become our substitute, and to pay the penalty, because we broke previous covenants, you'll see how. And with that representative, God wanted to cut a new and eternal covenant, so we could become part of that covenant through our representative. So God is a covenant God, and unless we understand the practice of the covenant and the meaning and the result of the covenant, we will not grasp his love for us. That message, "I will never leave you nor forsake you," you read it in the Bible. But that's a covenant promise. And many of you are still wondering, why does he love me now? I've been so bad, you know, I'm trying, but I don't seem to get there. Is God still loving me? And unless I understand covenant, I cannot root and ground myself in God's covenant love. Okay, so Jesus is the ultimate loving kindness towards humanity. And he is the keeping, the doing, and the showing of God's covenant oath. He made an oath to Abraham. We'll see how that happened. So, I would like to stop, like I'm going to present you the foundations, but then I would stop with the Abrahamic covenant because that's an important lesson and I would like you to get it next time. So, in the beginning, when he created the earth, God wanted children and the love relationship with them. None of us has asked to be born into this world, you know? Our parents want children. We don't ask to be born, and it was the same with God. He wanted to share this magnificent universe with his creation and to have a relationship with us. So, on top of that, if you read Genesis 1:26, he gave us power and authority. Interesting, in that verse it says, God says, let's create man, and he's speaking with the Trinity, with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Let's create man in our image and our likeness, and let man rule over the birds of the air and the fish of the seas and every living thing on the face of the earth. So in the ruling part, God does not include himself. So he's creating the earth for us to inhabit and to rule. Something that we have lost in the process. It's like, you know, like let's say my daughter gets married and I want to bless them and buy a house for them. So I'm buying the house for them. The house is in my name because I am the one who goes and cuts the deal. But I go to them and I give them the keys and I say, here, this is yours. You will be the owner of the house. You invite whoever you want, whenever you want. You will keep it clean. You will cook. You will do whatever you will. Bring your kids into the house. And if you invite me, I'm going to come over. But otherwise, I'm not going to claim the ownership of the place because I'm giving it to you. So I am still the owner of the house and they cannot sell it without me signing. But because I gave them the key and the authority, they are the ones who take care. And if they start inviting thieves or if they start doing stupid things like drugs and alcohol, they might lose it in the process. And that's happened with humanity too. We've lost the rulership of the earth because of our sin and carelessness. But we'll get it back. So Adam and Eve sinned and broke the covenant with God and lost that authority, right? So those keys, like, okay, this is your apartment, and someone else comes and they grab the keys because they were careless and they invited thieves in the house, so they lost that authority over the place. But God wanted to restore mankind to covenant relationship. So the covenant that Adam broke, God wanted to restore that covenant relationship. He wanted to show us how much he loves us. So the solution was to find another human without sin that could be the representative for the entire human race and cut a new and eternal blood covenant with him. So that was the point. That was the preparation. And everything we are going to see from now on, the covenant he cut with Noah and Moses and David, and actually they all lead final covenant he wanted to cut with Jesus on our behalf. It was done through a sequence of covenants, and we are as good as our sacrifice. So in a covenant, we become as good as our sacrifice, or as our representative. We'll talk about that later. So, I'm going to stop here tonight. Any questions? Any questions about the covenant, covenant practice, meaning of the covenant? Was it clear? Was it, yeah? Okay, yeah.
So could that be the reason why there is fighting in Africa? Might be certain things you were not right? And how do we send that away? Because we always fight.
The covenant were not meant to create the fights, were actually meant to protect the parties involved. So the covenant Stanley had with those tribes was to allow him the free way, because every time another tribe would try to attack him, he would show them the sign of the covenant and they would be afraid of the other. So the fights were already there when Livingstone and Stanley went in Africa. So those are things of the past. Okay, so we have to look into the African history and see when they all started. But the reason for the covenant was actually to stop the fights and to let them go through. So it worked in our their advantage. Yeah, good question. Anybody else? Yes? Yeah.
What do you think about that? Covenant with blood, it's my chance. Because it just came in my mind. So.
I know, and there is the Jehovah's Witnesses, I think, and they do not accept transfusions. I don't think that was the point of, because a transfusion is not a full transfer of one person to another person. And I think when God says that life is in the blood, and if you look at the medical science now, most of the tests, they come from the blood. And through the blood, they can read everything that's wrong in a human body, right? So there is so much information in the blood, and it's a special substance because that's why God has created this substance in us. Like the angels, they don't have the blood, so it was something created for men. But when you look back at covenants, people were mingling their blood as a symbol that now we become one, but it wasn't affecting them physically, if you want to put it that way. So my personal opinion is that the blood transfusion, when needed, is actually coming to support life, not to take it out. But it's, we can elaborate more on that. It's a good question. Yeah. Anybody else? No? Okay. There you go. Okay. Bless you. I just pray protection over you, and I really pray that things will start to unfold from you from a covenant standpoint, and you'll understand how secure you are in the eyes of the Father. And if you can bring your Bibles next time or your cell phones, you can start reading those verses because they are really important. And I'm not putting them on PowerPoint just to give you the chance to just go through the Bible and